Though some of the more inspiring money stories are usually of the rags to riches variety, just as interesting are those who were brought up to live a life of simplicity coupled with smart money management despite being very well off. It's another My Money Story episode coming up. I'm Edric Mendoza and this is On The Money. One such story of practicing unpretentiousness amid wealth is that of Lamoiyan's Joel Pedro, son of success story Cecilio Pedro. Welcome to the show, Joel.
Hi, Edric.
Thanks for being here, my brother from another mother.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah, so, you know, let's talk about the story of your family and the things you've learned about money. The first question is, tell me about your dad. Did you see him work hard to become the success that he is, or were you already born into a family where the business was growing, etc.?
It got established 1987. Mm-hmm. So I was born in 1984. Mm-hmm. So when that started, I was four mm-hmm. years old. So when my dad brought me up, I really didn't see the whole scenario of the business.
Right. You're very young.
At a very young age. Mm-hmm. Although what I do know is it's always there's always food on the table, mm-hmm. and it wasn't like we had to scamper for anything.
So when it first started, very small, no? It was still a very small operation back then.
The operation back then, we weren't making money for the first 5 years.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. It only started when we launched the kitty mm-hmm. toothpaste.
Okay.
That's when the company started.
Which is how many years into the?
If I'm not mistaken, it's about 6 years.
6 years already. The sixth year, then it kicked off. Now, yeah. So how was it growing up then? I mean, you said food was on the table. When the business started to pick up, 6 years old or 6 years later and up, did you start seeing any changes in the lifestyle, in the way that they treated you?
I grew up in our home in Pasay.
Okay.
Which was the house of my dad ever since he was.
His parents' house.
His parents' house.
Also, okay.
Yeah, so we were there for the longest time, and up to today, we still live in that place. So in terms of lifestyle right. and the house, it's still the same house ever since he was a high schooler.
Right. They still live there.
They still live there.
Because you're married now.
Yes, that's right. I don't live there anymore, right?
With Carolyn, your wife, yeah, okay. Yeah. So you're saying that even up to now, they pretty much kept the same type of lifestyle. You know, they didn't buy properties left and right and start moving to big houses, etc.
We have properties, mm-hmm. but it's not of the focus. Mm-hmm. I think that's a very important thing. Mm. With my dad's way of doing things, he's very focused on the business. Mm. If you see the past 25 years, mm-hmm. which we're celebrating this year, the more than 25 years.
Wow.
Yeah, the business have been very focused on doing oral care, personal care, and household mm-hmm. care. Mm. And I think that's one of his formulas on keeping it simple. Make sure you're heading towards the right direction of
focus. Don't buy things that will not help bring back to the business, right?
Yes.
Thanks, Joel. So tell me, now as you were being raised, how did your dad and your family instill the values of money and how to handle it properly despite all the success that was being experienced?
I grew up with an allowance.
Okay.
My parents, we have a earning system at home.
Okay.
For myself.
Right, right.
To put it that way.
Not and you are the only child.
Just yes.
Put it on the record. Right. Only child, right?
I'm the only child.
Right.
So
earning system.
Mm-hmm. Earning system in a very young age. Mm-hmm. We call it a point system.
Okay.
So different acts in the house, different acts in school earn you points. Mm-hmm. And these points, when you accumulate it, will result to a toy.
Okay, that was your allowance, the allowance was separate?
The allowance was separate.
Okay.
I remember getting 20 pesos for my allowance back in...
20 pesos.
20
right.
pesos. So, yeah. at a
per
very
day,
young...
Per
week.
Per week?
Yes.
Okay.
Malaki yun.
4 pesos
that was,
a day.
That right. was a lot.
Right, back then.
back then.
Okay, all right.
So, when I get my allowance, at a very young age, they always taught me to budget it. Meaning, you have to make... things fit between your in between the 20 pesos for the week. Mm-hmm. And so I was brought up in a way that you have to manage your money and know where to spend it.
Mm. And this is in your elementary years or this is high school already?
This is my
elementary
year.
Years already. They're teaching yes. you these things. Okay.
And with the point system, so I get to accumulate points, a good grade, 100 is a certain point. I don't exactly remember
the point metric. Don't worry. The yeah. principle is clear. Okay.
But we have points, and at the end of the year, you get let's say 150 points. You can buy any toy in a department store with 4 digits.
With 4 digits.
4 digits, including the decimal point. Okay.
so
that's actually less than 100 pesos.
Less than 100 pesos. Okay. All right. Which was good. I think all told, right? So they gave you that system, and so by doing that, what did you learn?
Well, what I learned is at a very young age is money is something earned, and it's not something that's just thrown at you. Mm. And it's not something that you
grows
can just
off trees,
grows off trees and just pick it out. Mm-hmm. So the value of how hard it's earned has been instilled in a very young age for me.
That's good. And it translated, right? I mean, you didn't suddenly, when you finally made your own money, you didn't start saying, well, now it's my time, now I will splurge. No, you continued that on.
That value of learning to budget mm-hmm. is actually, I would say, something that I keep dearly, mm-hmm. even up to this day. Mm-hmm. And it has all translated to how I manage my money and how I go about making decisions.
Examples that you saw from your parents, like, do you remember moments when they actually showed it? In other words, they didn't just say, Joel, do this, right? Budget and all that, but you saw it in their example. Can you give stories or moments when you can remember them actually modeling that to you?
With a lot of times, I remember mm-hmm. my parents telling me a story of giving. Mm. A story of my parents are very generous, mm. especially with the ministry, mm. with the kingdom of God. Mm-hmm. My dad has a soft heart for the deaf, mm. and that has always been his advocacy mm. for the hearing impaired. Mm. And actually, up to this day, we do hire
continue to hire. That's been featured many times
in our uh-huh. company. So by modeling this, I think mm-hmm. the way my parents showed it is through how being generous mm-hmm. in giving, mm-hmm. being generous in not counting what you're giving. Mm-hmm. That's always been their model. Okay. And they always give me this principle that, you know, you can never outgive God. Mm.
That is so true.
When you give, don't complain. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, they tell us, after you give, is there a time that you lacked? Mm. Is there a time that we lacked after right. giving? That's never the case. In fact, after you giving, after mm-hmm. giving, God usually showers more
right.
into what they have.
Right. Now, part of giving, as your parents modeled it, what other systems or techniques, if you will, do you remember your dad showing when it came to handling his own money, despite, you know, all the success around him?
When handling money, we have a simple principle. Mm-hmm.
Does he invest, for example? Does he tithe? I mean, yeah.
When he gives us this principle that mm-hmm. that I strongly believe in, mm-hmm. if there anything that you need, no matter how expensive it is, spend it. Mm-hmm. If there's anything that you want, no matter how inexpensive, try to save it. That's a very basic principle.
Try to save for it or try to not buy it?
Well, put it this way. You can first consult God mm-hmm. whether you need it or not.
Right.
And if it says yes, then go ahead.
Right.
But the principle of thinking it two times, three times, four times before even spending on something you want.
I see.
So not really right. saving so you can spend it right. next time.
Which is a fault of many people, right? They confuse the needs and wants, they buy things.
Right.
So let's talk about your personal finance
sure.
formula. Do you invest? What is the way that you manage your own money now? You're a young family guy. What principles do you apply when it comes to managing your money?
For investing, number one, don't forget to tithe. At least 10%. Now that's the minimum. Mm-hmm. If God asks you to tithe more or give to a certain, go ahead.
Individual or
over the 10%, that's part of it.
Okay.
The rest, I go with the principle again. If you don't need to spend it, the rest is savings.
Right. So you don't have any specific amount. Okay, every month I need to have this amount, and then I will put it in the market, equity market.
Yeah. If you're talking about savings, mm-hmm. I give at least 20%. That's a minimum.
You set that aside.
If you spend it first, usually you don't end up with 20%.
There you go. Okay.
So for an X amount, you put 20% in as your savings.
Right.
Then 10% at least for tithing. And the rest is your revolving fund.
Okay. I'm going to ask maybe one or two more questions, and then we'll go to the viewer questions for you, Joel. The question I wanted to ask you is, are there any money lessons you've learned the hard way?
I had an experience before on doing the stock market, and to keep it short, that experience, I think back in the 90s, I think 97 or 98, really, that was my first experience of losing money. This was something that was set up by my parents for me as a portfolio before. Mm-hmm. And basically, I didn't know what it was. As I said, hey, this is for long-term investment. Mm-hmm. This is for something that, you know, maybe for my future. Mm-hmm. And I get to manage it. Mm-hmm. So I was blessed with that. Mm-hmm. But given that scenario before, I didn't know what the consequences were on that certain certain structure or portfolio.
Right. You didn't study it properly.
I didn't know it was there. Yeah. It was basically, that was one of those things where, okay, you have this.
I understand.
You take that in. So for me, it's like, okay, what's this? Then we'll just take care of it then. All right, I'll not touch it. It's been there for a while.
Okay.
So given that, I lost everything.
Because you just kept it there. You didn't not understand what it was about. So from that learning.
But upon losing everything, you value, that taught me the value of not everything that is the most important thing in the world is money. There are other things that are more important, because at a snap, no matter how much you earn, or how much you have, it could just disappear.
Right, and I guess investigate before you invest, knowing also what it was about.
Yeah. So understand, I think the most important thing is when you want to invest in something, read the fine print.
Sure, makes sense.
Understand what you're going into. Understand the risks that are involved.
Right.
And for me, generally, anything that's too hard to believe or too big a return, it's not worth it.
That makes sense. Okay, on that note, we're going to pause for a short break. Stay tuned. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On the Money. Let's check what Salve Duplito has for us in Salve Says.
In the heart of Quiapo, you will find a wholesale store that will make every accessory buff go wild, plus some fun stuff for men and women alike. Come with me. This place supplies some big brands that you see in huge shopping malls. Here you can get accessories, toys, and fashion jewelries at half the price. And if you're buying in bulk, you get additional discounts.
Maraming pupunta dito, lalo na peak season, November, December, pag malapit na yung bare months. Kasi yung mga gift items namin marami, saka yung mga accessories, katulang bracelet, and feng shui items meron din kami dito. Maraming mga mayayaman na pupunta dito. Akala nila pag Quiapo, ano lang, ay palengke, Kadiri, pero pangit naman yung ganun, parang dinidiscriminate nila yung Quiapo. May maganda din sila makikita dito sa Quiapo, katulad nito. Pag naka 5,000 worth, 5% less, pero dun sa iba namin regular customer, nagkakaroon na lang kami ng additional discount sa kanila. Almost 50% o kaya 100% kasi ang patong nila doble din.
As you can see, finding good deals is easy. With a little more planning, all of us can spend wisely and outsmart the cost of convenience.
Still with us is Lamoyan's Joel Pedro, son of success story Cecilio Pedro, and of course, Melissa Hecolea with Your Money Questions. Hi, Mel.
Hi, Edric. Hi, Joel.
Hi.
Interesting story, actually.
Interesting,
and that last, the last story you told us about losing that money, that must have been tough. Do you think that was one of the best lessons you actually learned because it was such a painful lesson, in a sense?
That story that I told could have just, the simple lesson that I learned from it would be, nobody would earn your money for you.
Okay.
And if you want to earn something, you have to personally go get it. Personally understand what you're getting into, and personally know the risks that you're taking.
Sure.
And
sure.
You have a better success rate.
As long as you keep an eye on it and know everything about it.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Anyway, let's start with the viewer questions. George asks, are you a fan of investing in the stock market, especially now that it's doing so well? If not, what are your ways of making your personal finances grow outside the company?
For me, on the stock market, I would suggest for this on my own experience, mm-hmm. is you set your limits. If you have 100%, you have to understand how much risk you want to take. Mm-hmm. Is it a 70% on mutual funds and 30% on equities? Mm-hmm. How much risk do you want to take? Mm-hmm. And when I get into it right now, I always say, like before, if I go in 100% on stocks, mm-hmm. right now, if I want to play it safer, I'll just go 30% on stocks.
Right.
At least when you lose or you gain, you know you're not losing everything. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, I also like to say you can never define how much you can gain in a stock market, but you can always define how much you can lose. Mm. So it depends on how...
That makes sense. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So your threshold, basically.
Yes.
Yeah.
So sometimes, like for myself, I would say if I lose up to, let's say, 10%, I'm out. If I gain up to 10%, I'm also getting out.
Right.
So realize, for me, realize the profit if you can. And, you know, in the stock game, if you can realize your loss, know how far you can go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Some would do it that way, yeah.
So you're invested in the stock market. Do you also do mutual funds or UITFs? How are you diversified?
The UITFs and mutual funds, I have some people managing that for me.
Okay.
I give them the same thing. I give them my tolerance limit. Mm-hmm. On how much, let's say if I want it at 8%, look for the best structure for me at 8%. And I can only limit myself to losing an X percent, and that's how I manage it.
Okay, wow, so you really know yourself and you really know your risk tolerance.
You know, just thresholds as well.
Yeah,
that's very important.
Right. Yeah. It is. Okay, now we have a question from Jeffrey who asks, I also work for my dad in the company he started, and I've been loyal for the past 4 years. Mm-hmm. I feel I deserve a raise, but I am ashamed to bring it up with him.
Yeah.
How do you find that open line of communication with your dad?
Nice question. Good question.
Yes.
I can only speak for myself. Mm-hmm. When I joined the company, my dad offered me a package. So I am treated in every way like an employee. Mm. I have my leaves, I have my car plan, and you name it. It's like any normal benefit.
Mm-hmm. Of an employee.
An employee. Mm-hmm. So that's how I got into the company. Now with the question of getting a raise, it depends. I come from a very Chinese family, mm-hmm. and a very Chinese background, mm-hmm. but my dad's thinking is very Western. So we don't have a difficulty talking about, hey, this is my idea. We can share ideas. Mm-hmm. We can disagree with each other at times. And we still come out as buddies.
It's just business.
Although some of the meetings happen in our boardroom called the sofa at home.
I like that. The living room boardroom.
He can call that meeting at any time.
Right.
Yeah, without suits. But I guess you have to see how the formula of your parents are, mm-hmm. or how your father would mm-hmm. be. Mm-hmm. Are they the conversational type? But I would sincerely say that if you give your best, like when I get a raise, I haven't asked for a raise.
You don't ask for a raise.
I don't ask for a raise.
Okay.
I haven't had to ask for a raise. When doing business, he says that he's been in the business for 4 years. Mm-hmm. When doing it, you gotta love what you're doing. Mm. For me, I grew up even as a kindergarten guy. Mm-hmm. I already said, like, yeah, this is my speech as a kindergarten. Someday when I grow up, I want to be like my dad, driving the happy truck.
Yeah. Literally.
Literally.
So truck.
So right? As a little kid.
Yeah.
That was an exact line I said before.
Yeah.
So ever since I was a kid, I really enjoyed business.
Right.
It wasn't something that was forced on me. Like, hey, you have to get into a business someday.
Yeah.
So eventually when that opportunity came, by God's grace, mm-hmm. when that came in, it wasn't a burden for me. Mm. Yes, there are a lot of challenges mm-hmm. where we don't agree, mm-hmm. different styles. Mm-hmm. My dad's very visionary. Mm. I come up with an approach of a more calculated, use a little bit more of science and numbers to prove a point.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where the interplay comes in.
Mm-hmm.
So with him, with the question, if you enjoy what you're doing and you're passionate about what you're doing, the money comes after.
The raises and all those things will also follow.
The drive mm-hmm. of doing things should be the passion for doing it.
Mm.
And from what I experience, the raise and the money, your parents, your dad, my dad sees it, and I don't even have to ask for it. So it just comes.
I see.
Okay, now Isabel asks, has Lamoiyan ever considered listing in the PSE? It seems as though it would be the best time to do so.
For the company has been in an expansion mode ever since. Mm-hmm. And the past two, three years has been very aggressive. That is something in the horizon. But like we say, when you, it's not as simple as listing it in the public and you're done.
Right.
When you listen to the public, there has to be a strong direction on where it's going. Where will the money go? What investments will we get into? Mm-hmm. Who's going to head the company? Mm-hmm. What is the structure of the company? Mm-hmm. So these are all the preparations we're doing to eventually get into that.
Can you give us a peek at where the company is going to go?
Basically, we're an oral care, personal care, and household company. Mm-hmm. So anything on those lines of products and anything of those lines of business are where we are expanding.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sticking
great.
To the focus, right? As what you
yes.
said earlier. Yeah.
Okay, now the next question comes from Tina, who asks, are you involved in any personal philanthropic endeavors? Surely Lamoiyan has its own projects as a successful company.
I kind of know the answer to that one, but go ahead.
Lamoyan's advocacy, is, mm-hmm. if I may, are with the deaf.
Okay, why the deaf?
That has been my dad's thing for the longest time.
Okay.
And even up to today, we hire about 30% of our employees in the workforce.
Wow.
Personally, I am
personal advocacy.
Personal.
Yeah.
Personally, yes. I am involved in a music ministry.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so,
why music ministry?
Ever since I've been exposed to a lot of instruments. Mm-hmm. So I play the piano and drums and the violin. Mm-hmm. So
wow.
That ministry of mine is usually in a band mm-hmm. with my mm-hmm. wife. Mm-hmm. We play together.
Yeah. For free. That's why it's philanthropic.
For free. Philanthropic, yes.
For church activities, mm. yeah.
Church activities. Yeah. And that's the way of ministering to different groups.
Where did you learn this principle of giving from?
My optimal example would be my dad. I remember this story. I couldn't believe he did this. Back then, when the company was starting, mm-hmm. he has a story of giving to a ministry of 300,000. I think that was a 300,000 check.
Wow.
But this 300,000 check is not—it's not the value that is of the essence of this story.
Right.
Back then, when we were starting, everything was a hand-to-mouth. You mm-hmm. have to get your receivables to do your payables. Mm-hmm. At that time, when that ministry amount came in, I remember the story not having anything in the bank.
Oh, wow.
So it was an act of faith, a step of faith.
Yes.
But why did that happen? Because God really called him to give it to this ministry. And that act of faith, when giving it out, he didn't know where it came from. But 3 days later, today it's not 3 days anymore, right?
Yeah. right. That's right.
3 days later, when it cleared, the money came in.
They had money to
that
actually
provide.
That
is incredible. I think it's incredible. Your dad really is your role model ever since you were young.
I think everybody has a mentor, and I would consider him one of my mentors, earthly mentors, mm-hmm. to business, to life, and to how to live out for God.
Mm-hmm. You've been dealing with.
Send us your money questions via email or through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Start them off young. It's one of the things I'm learning here, right?
Yes.
I mean, you were taught at a very young age the values of hard work, right? And money doesn't grow off trees. Mm-hmm. And now, look at the man you are becoming, even. Thank you again, Joel. Mel?
That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more Talk and Tips so you're always right on the money.